Good evening, everyone. I'm Werner Egypsy from Earthkeepers Connect Goa, your host for this evening, the 15th day of the pre-summit webinars leading up to the New Earth Summit in November, second edition of India's first integrative summit on solutions to our problems in health, food, farming, and the environment. I extend a warm welcome to our esteemed panelists of this evening. On behalf of our summit convener, Daryl D'Souza, and also on behalf of our 10 Earthkeeper groups in India and overseas. And we express our gratitude to you for taking out time from your busy schedules to be with us and to share your wisdom so that all watching this webinar and its recording later may understand how best to make choices that help healthier foods come into our regular food supply chains. For if we stick to old choices, we will not see a better future. Our topic for today is cleaning our toxic food supply chain. I will start by introducing our panelists to the audience, Vinod Kumari. Vinod Kumari, the co-founder of EcoLive and Healthy Lives Foundation, was an IT professional for 17 years before she turned into a wellness professional. She experienced the power of naturopathy while treating her own sinusitis, allergies, and weight issues. She decided to take it forward as a movement to make people aware and benefit from it. She left her corporate career 7 years ago and started her own naturopathy wellness center, EcoLive, in Gurgaon. EcoLive has been treating many people in India and abroad through naturopathy. Vinod is also a certified mind trainer. Her mission is to motivate, guide, and help more and more people to live healthy in natural ways and live in harmony with nature. Daryl D'Souza. Daryl D'Souza's reversal from 14 years of sickness to a state of complete well-being within just 1 year of using integrated natural therapies is a story that has inspired millions across the globe to lead healthier lives. His book, Become Healthier Extinct, on curing chronic illnesses with integrated natural therapies, finds readership in close to 200 countries. Daryl does disease reversal workshops as well as spiritual workshops all across India. And he also served a 5-year term as the secretary of the World United Doctors and Healers Association. He hosts platforms and events for doctors, healers, and therapists to work together and has curated and convened 4 mind, body, and spirit healing conferences. Daryl is also an organic farmer, an environmentalist, a TEDx speaker, founder of Earthkeepers Connect, ambassador of Vegan Nation, convener of the New Earth Summit, and a speaker at the World Parliaments on Spirituality. Bhagyashree Sheikh. Bhagyashree Sheikh is an ardent zoologist and nature lover. She did her master's in environmental science from the renowned Institute of Sciences, Mumbai. A merit student and state topper in her favorite subjects, she soon found herself lecturing the postgraduates. She is also a black belt in karate and went on to become an instructor when she was only 20 years old. After actively involving herself in various environmental campaigns in Mumbai, she chose the Khazan Land Ecosystem of Goa as her project work with ICAR, Old Goa, for her post-graduation. For 10 years then, she is meeting farmers and understanding challenges faced by them. She followed her nature lover husband, Irfan Sheikh, to his native place, Goa. Together, they are actively involved in promoting sustainable lifestyle practices in Goa through their social enterprise called Ease Eco Solutions. And in a short span of time, they have already conducted various free herbal gardening workshops in schools, colleges, and villages. They also have set up a free marketing platform called Sustainable Lifestyle Market, Sulimark, to promote organic farming and farmers. So now we'll begin the 3 rounds of questions for our panelists that will conclude in 1 hour. so that we can keep the next hour for Q&A with the attendees and the audience. Accordingly, I request each panelist to address each question in a maximum of 7 minutes. To our audience, if you would like to receive the recorded video of this webinar, please subscribe to our YouTube channel, The New Earth Summit. Our audience will type their questions in the Q&A box below after each round of the panel completes and need not wait for 7 p.m. So here's our first question for the panelists. What, according to you, is unhealthy or toxic food? What detrimental effect does it have to the human body? Does its consumption impact our ecosystem as well? We can talk about packaging also. So we'll start with Bhagyashree Sheikh.
Hello. Yes. When we talk about food, it is mostly we look for nutritional value of the food. People mostly eat fruits, fresh vegetables, specifically green vegetables, in order to obtain nutrition. But when we see there is a heavy use of pesticides, pest repellents, and then there are growth yield boosters, lot of sort of chemicals are used while doing cultivation and harvesting of this different kind of foodstuff. So when we consume them, even though you follow healthy or very preparation methods, the residue of the chemical which is there in the food, we can't deny that. And the more we consume that, the more it remains in the system. So one pesticide, one chemical, likewise there are many retained in the body. There are there in the mother's milk, there are there in our blood, there are there in our skin also. So all these things which are there accumulated in the body, further they lead to different hormonal and developmental issues, especially in case of females. So when the female is like childbearing, all those chemicals and all are transplanted to given to children also. When we say food, whatever most of the people here we are consuming is a toxic food, we can say.
All right. Thank you. Vinod Kumari, would you like to share with us?
Yeah, sure. So I actually call the unhealthy or toxic food is the food which is not in alignment with nature's process. The way it is grown, the way it is consumed, if it is not in alignment with the process, that is the toxic food, that is the way I call it. And specifically the food which has chemicals, genetically modified, have a lot of preservatives, and has gone through a lot of processing where it loses its nutrients. So all these things make it, you know, at every stage, making it more and more toxic. And it actually leads to, you know, as Bhagyashree said, a lot of toxin accumulation in your body. And by design, our system is designed to keep throwing this toxin out of this body, even at every cell level. So just imagine, you know, if we have completely toxic kind of food, how much extra load you are putting on your overall system on a day-to-day basis with each and every meal. Because this is a natural process. The moment your system identifies there is a toxin and it will try to throw out. Whether it is able to throw out 100% or 50%, that depends upon your capacity, but it will actually keep trying to throw. So you are creating unnecessarily, you know, load on your system. And as we say, food is the fuel for your body or the medicine for your body. So if we, you know, we need to be very mindful what kind of fuel are we giving to our body. We are very conscious about our other machineries, you know, even if it is a car or anything, whatever it needs, you know, we will buy the best quality, even petrol or diesel or best quality, whatever you need. But when it comes to our body, you know, unfortunately, we have lost that kind of connect with the food. And we have started taking food as an activity, which we need to do on daily basis, maybe 3 times, 4 times. And just do it either as a mandate, or some people do it as a fun or as a luxury also. So they keep experimenting with this consciously and unconsciously both. So by this way, we are consuming a lot of toxins in your body, and we are seeing the impact as a society. You know, I'm into wellness industry, and it is really shocking. I will share with you that even in the teenager girls, you know, I've talked to a couple of girls in class 9th or 10th, and they have been telling me that almost 50% girls are having PCOD issues at the age of, you know, this 14, 15, which is actually shocking, because these kind of issues, even in my time, or even my mother's time, it was very, very rare at the age of maybe 40s or that time. And it is happening, you know, in front of our eyes, all these issues, diabetes, obesity, migraine, insomnia, many kind of issues. So we are actually making the humanity sick day by day without realizing what harm we are doing to ourselves, to environment. I mean, nobody has any clue on that, what we are doing. And we, all of us know what capacity we put a human as on the pedestal, you know, which you create in this universe, that they are, it is the most intelligent or species which has knowledge. And unfortunately, we are not doing anything with this potential, because there we can reach, and what we are doing with this body, you know, people are struggling with even running day-to-day basic lives. Forget about reaching to higher level or higher consciousness, where we can do some wonders in this world. So unfortunately, we have damaged all of this, and not even at a physical level. It is shocking that it is impacting your mental wellness also, even at the mind level. You know, as we say in India, jaisa ann, waisa man. Right? So we are made up of what we eat. That's why they say. And this is something which people are not connecting with it, that you are what you eat. And that is the reason they're just consuming the kind of food they're consuming today. So unconsciously and consciously, we are doing this. And it's not only the impact on just human health. If you see at ecology level, it is impacting everybody, starting from you know, human health, their impact on mind, then even in the environment, you know, the impact of having chemical-based food, it is impacting even animals. It is impacting the quality of your plants. It is impacting eventually your soil. It is degrading your soil. It is contaminating your air, even water to such a large extent. So it is a complete circle. It is not just impact on us. It is impacting everything. Having this toxin-based food is impacting each and every element of this universe.
Thank you. Thank you, Vinod. Now I would ask Daryl to share a few words with us.
Yes. Thank you, Verna. And I very much agree with both the panelists, and just want to, you know, add something further. So I consider in the area of toxic food, anything that is unhealthy food, anything that is going to make the human body sick, okay, over a period of time. So in that category, first comes what is not food for human being, you know, whether it's organic or not, you know, and that was what my TEDx talk was about. And today also I had a question on my online workshop from a lady, you know, out of now the batch has gone to about 100 people. And she's a new participant in the workshop. So people have got notions that so many things are food, but when they are actually not food, and, you know, they don't get the right kind of information. So this first talk was about, you know, this question was about milk and her mother-in-law or her mother was having repeated kidney stones. And I was just trying to explain, as it is written in my book also, the undigested calcium from cow's milk that retains in the human body, it goes and forms kidney stones in the long run. And so, but she was replying, but my doctor says that, you know, that if the milk should be had, you know, if you have kidney stones. So now people are and it's not people's fault because they have never been told you know what is pure nutrition and good nutrition for the human body. And the MBBS course also doesn't have a proper subject on nutrition where they tell you actually what are the foods that are healthy for the human body and what to have and how much to have and what not to have. So only when you see the real cycles in nature, then you will see that no mammals are having milk after the age of 3 or 4 years. Okay, so it is very clear that, and the mammals, the mothers themselves don't lactate after 2 years of produce or 3 years of producing a baby. So there's no question of milk being there around for any adult mammal on this planet to have milk. So there are some very basics that people are missing. So that's the first level, and in that I've got things like too much of oil, fried. There's no other species on this planet who will fry their foods. But even the ape and the monkey and the chimpanzee has a lot of lubrication for their joints because they get pure oil from nuts and seeds and beans and roots and bark of trees. So for me, that is the first level of toxic food. We are having many poisons over there. One of them is milk and milk products. Then second is too much of fried foods. And then, of course, processed sugar, that's also very toxic for the human body. Even if it's organic, it creates a lot of imbalance in the digestive system. And it creates a breeding ground also for more to multiply pathogens if you're having too much of processed sugar. So that's the first part of toxic food for me and unhealthy. The second is when people go to the vegetable markets and they buy fresh food every day, but that is grown on soils which have got so many chemicals for the soil and for the pests and all of that. That's the second level of toxic food. And then the third level of toxic food, which I think is the most harmful, is where human beings have put a lot of their activity into, and those are processed foods. And mainly they are found in all the big malls and supermarkets, which is the fad of today. You ask any modern person about food, they will straight away take you to a mall. They will never take you to the vegetable market. If you say I want a good treat, or they'll take you to a food court somewhere in the mall. So these processed food products, they've got so many chemicals in them, and they've got stabilizers also, which are chemicals that prevent cross reactions between other chemicals in the food. And when the can or the Tetra pack is tightly packed and airtight, it's a stable structure of chemicals, like I call it atomic warfare, is stabilized. That stabilizer, it stabilizes atomic warfare going on in the tin. You bring it home and you open it and put it in your body, in your mouth, and then they all are free and they act like free radicals. They start robbing electrons from your throat and from your stomach, entire digestive tract. And that is the reason so many people are suffering from inflammation, ulcers, then which goes on to tumors and then becomes cancer. So people are wondering why is cancer going up in society. You just look at the rate of how much processed food people are eating. Okay, that food is not made by nature. It is made these formulas all come from scientific labs. Okay, putting all these chemicals which are unnatural to the human body. So for me, that's the most toxic kind of food that is there. And that, of course, makes you sick and gives you all of these diseases. And all of the materials that go into making these packaged food products, right? So tin. For tin, you need to take out ore from the earth. So you're making holes in the earth. Then if the Tetra Pak, you're cutting down trees. And the inside is lined with plastic. So that comes from petroleum. So they are digging, taking out more crude oil from the earth. And if it's a glass bottle, you're excavating more sand. So it's a depletion of all these natural resources on the planet. Then these manufacturing companies that make this food, they are putting smoke in the air. They are putting all the chemical dyes and all into the ground, which come out in our rivers. So just because people have not understood that real food is something that is fresh without chemicals, and they go in for all this marketing and all these artificial foods, we have not only a lot of sickness happening to the human body, but a lot of, Vinod also pointed out, and this is what she was indicating, a lot of environmental damage. Okay, so of course, all of these factories running and, creating so much heat, it is contributing to global warming. And all the manufacturing in different places, and transporting them using vehicles and petrol, that also adds to, you know, carbon footprint. So you have, you know, this processed food, which seems to be at the top level of the most destructive food for the human body and for the entire planet. So that, you know, what I is, and the way it has come about is that just very simple, you know, certain businessmen who thought that they should make money off us by giving us food. I mean, that is a fine business, but when you give us food in such packages that cause us sickness and damage and the planet also, obviously that is not good. And because of the marketing, you know, we are going to all of them. And so the better alternative is to eat something fresh and local that will keep us, you know, healthy and not damage the ecosystem.
Great. Thank you, everyone. So now the next question is, why do people eat such foods? So I will ask Vinod to share with us.
Sure. In fact, you know, I spoke to a couple of children also, including my daughter. She's 12 years old. The primary reason which specifically children are saying is the taste. Why they are eating this food, because it tastes not always better, what they said, but it is very different and very addictive, you know, which they want to have a different experience. So that's the, you know, main reason they are experiencing or tasting pizzas or different kind of biscuit. There are a lot of variety in terms of taste. When it comes to home-based food, they feel it is more of vegetables. You know, you can experience maybe in some houses just 4 or 5 different varieties. So they get a lot of varieties in terms of taste buds. The second very influential thing is the impact by the media. What they see on specific ads or movies. I actually remember when I think of Maggie, you know, there used to be an ad, I forgot who was the actor, but, you know, it was having fun with friends and that's where they're going out and having Maggie, even in the night celebrating birthday party, they're having Maggie. So you'll find, you know, Maggie very popular in youngsters. You will hardly find any college canteen where there is no Maggie. People will just go and order the first thing, Maggie and chai. Right? So it has, I would say it's a gradual conditioning of children, which the media and entertainment industry is doing. What they show there in terms, whether it is food, you know, whole society is copying so many things, even the kind of attire they wear. So even food also has an impact, what you show on the media, what you are eating, and how are you celebrating? What do you mean by celebration? So all this has very gradual impact, which people don't realize that actually it has impacted us. If you question them, you know, you are influenced by media, they would not accept most probably. But we know, and I understand how mind works. Unconsciously, if you keep talking about same thing, show it 200 times and in a happy manner, your mind will absorb. It's a good thing. So it has a very deep impact on the society, and that is something which should change in the media. The third thing is in today's life, you know, it's very fast life. Everybody wants everything quick. You know, people don't have patience even to cook or even to have their meal. Mostly people are, you know, finishing their food while they're finishing something else, which is more important than food. So it is not as important. So in order to do this fast, what helps them, you know, if something is readily available, packaged, which they can carry in the car while driving and finish it, which they can have during the meeting. So all these things have created probably the ease of having something, they're able to carry something. These are the positive aspects which they are looking into this, and that is the reason they are consuming. And yes, there is a challenge that if we have to do something similar, we need to match these challenges. But definitely, these are the things And it's everywhere, you know, it's not in the metros or just fast-paced cities. Even, so I come from a village background and I see the shift happening even in the villages, which is very shocking. I do talk about with those people that why are you changing? You know, you should just stay whatever is there in your farm, cook it with love, eat it. But that's happening. So that's again the influential, you know, the media part comes into picture, which, you know, they are absorbing. But it's happening everywhere. So I think, and then the last point I was thinking, it's more of peer pressure. So even if you have families who believe in healthy food, who has trained their kids to have healthy food, but at some point in time, they will realize, you know, either their kids have started feeling that, you know, we are not doing this fun activity, which is happening somewhere else, and we are eating all these boring food, or which is not so in thing in the market which we are doing. So it sometimes it becomes a kind of peer pressure also, which people tend to fall prey to it, and they just do it. But I think you know, percentage will be very less, but it increases. You know, the more you feel that pressure, you'll keep doing that more often. As Daryl had pointed out, if there is a party, nobody thinks about you know, doing it in the house or doing it with the home made food, which used to happen earlier. You know, in our childhood times, we used to celebrate birthdays at home where mom used to cook. But that's not happening anymore. So these are a couple of things which came to my mind, why people are doing it, in spite of knowing it is unhealthy and it is causing damage to our health also.
Yes, thank you, Vinod. Very interesting point. I'll ask Bhagyashree, are you with us?
So, the question is like, why people eat this kind of food? And as ma'am rightly said, mainly it is because people are not that aware what they are eating. And they have this influence from different, like there are traditional ways, there are different methods of cooking, which are getting affected by a lot of this advertisement, as she currently said. Different trends are there, different diets are there, different food habits like fats are there, this is good for your health, that is good, all that is there, but how to eat that and what to eat, how to eat, that guidance is not there. People are not that aware about what they're choosing, different choices which are there. Whatever comes on magazine that this is good for your child, this will boost memory of the child, people go for that, thinking, okay, this will actually help me, without actually giving it a second thought, see how that food is processed and if it is packaged and all. Likewise. Hello?
Yes, yes, Bhagyashree, yes. I think we've lost you. Hello?
Hello?
Yes, yes. Yes.
It. And this advertisement world and all this TV media, print media, different things which are advertised, different packaged food which is coming in, like ready to mix. And there is a term that grab your food. So we don't have more time to sit and have it peacefully, enjoy the way it is done, like having water before the food and all. So all that is not there. Everything is made compact. So that one item meal, all that is coming up in market. And people are falling prey for it, the busy lifestyle and all. So that is further leading to a lot of lifestyle diseases and all. And people are actually not cautiously thinking. The food, what we eat, is making our body and different choices in the life. Yeah. So that awareness and basically that cautious choice is required for that choosing the food.
Thank you, Bhagyashree. Now I request Daryl to share with us.
Yes, thank you, Varna. Pretty nice, yeah, very good points put forth, you know, first starting with Vinod, and I completely agree with her that it's more of a mind game and a conditioning and a hypnotism that people are under. Like she said, peer pressure and, you know, so many things. And I just want to give another angle to it also, one additional thing which people don't seem to realize. So Yes, there is so much of, you know, I'm mainly talking about people who have made it their business to feed us. Okay. They will not stop. They are, of course, businesses. So there's a lot of investment, a lot of effort, a lot of marketing, and so much is done over there. And it would have all been, you know, very good if what they were giving us was healthy and would, you know, not damage the planet. But now the problem is that first of all, these people have not really understood what is food, you know, anything. And like Vinod also said, it's the taste that's put in the food and the additives in it. Some of them are purposely put to, and they're addictive in nature. Okay, so that's why the children and the even your youngsters or adults go back again, you know, for the same kind of food. So this is all part of the marketing and consumer retention kind of tactics that they do just to promote a business. It's very clear now, since, you know, at least the last 10 years, it is abundantly clear for people who are, you know, are researching and bringing out the evidence, and people who are getting sick and giving up, you know, all these kind of toxic foods and getting healed. It is known in the world now that these packaged and processed foods are making you sick. But still, these companies that, you know, make this, instead of changing into something more healthier, they're increasing their budgets on how to do more and more marketing and how to make, you know, put more of these addictive substances in food. So now, the second part is that generally people don't understand the connection between what they are eating and the sicknesses they are getting. It's only now that cancer is on the rise. And when it's become so late that you've got ulcers inside your intestine and you've got abscesses and your entire gut lining is inflamed and you are dying, it's only that time those people are realizing what they have been eating and what they have been doing for so many years. Right. So it seems that people are not ready to understand things, and they will rather go for, you know, good TV ad, what looks nice in a magazine, what is there on the roadside that looks very attractive, you know, go for it now. So I think the big thing is a disconnect between people, awareness of the damage that these artificial, I call them, they all man-made artificial foods, you know, they don't see the picture. So that's, I think, a major component of why they go for it. They think it's something good. Now, because of so much of understanding and clarity, you see on that cigarette packet, you see the this picture of cancer, okay? That you will get cancer, you get lung cancer or throat cancer. Now imagine if that same kind of principle was applied and put on every, you know, packaged food and processed food product. How many people would pick it up? But that is the reality from the research that is there. Now this research is coming out from people who are working with real patients and real life scenarios, and those people know the truth who are reversing the illnesses. And not the other people who are just manufacturing food. Food manufacturers do not know what the food is going to do to people. It's only the therapists and the healers and the nutritionists and the naturopaths and the Ayurvedic practitioners and natural medicine practitioners. When they change foods and those fresh foods heal people, only they know the sciences. Now, unfortunately, their marketing budgets are not, they are individuals and they are small setups in different places. So the thing is, yeah, their marketing budget is hardly anything. So people have to realize this, the real people who are giving you health and giving you healthy food, even the farmer, if there's an organic farmer and all, what is his big marketing budget and all that? Do you see the ads on the TV for the organic produce? How many millions or billions of rupees or dollars are going into that marketing? People are just sitting in front of the TV and picking, you know, whatever is marketed well. So unfortunately, these, you know, processed packaged foods, they are such a huge trillion dollar business on the planet. And people are just, you know, going in for it till they get ulcers, till they get, you know, cancer. perhaps that is one route through which they will know the truth. And otherwise, they have to, you know, look at people who are reversing illnesses and try to figure out from where did you learn this, and you know, how come it's how it's working for you, and you know, truth is over there. So I think people need to look at all those who are reversing illnesses, and they should ask them, okay, what is reversing illnesses for you? And then those people can tell the truth. You don't need to get some laboratory test from somewhere when somebody is, you know, diabetes, high BP, cholesterol, diabetes, obesity, hormonal imbalance, you know, arthritis, all those things are getting reversed by a healthy diet. We don't need any laboratory or some national research or global research or World Health Organization to tell us what is working and what is not, because it is working for the people. So I think people should start sharing real knowledge. And every person who reverses illness with healthy food, it is their responsibility to tell others, because if they don't, certainly these businesses are not doing that work. They are just making money off us, and whether we get cancer or we get cataract, glaucoma, or have to have a hysterectomy, they don't care at all. Okay, they just care about their business. So I think that's the, you know, real scenario now in the world.
Great. Thanks, Daryl. So the next question is, how do we replace all these toxic foods in our food supply chains and their packaging, of course? So, Bhagyashree, would you like to take this?
Yeah, when we are aware that what we are eating is something not natural, we must try growing it ourselves. I very well understand not everybody is farmer, or not that everybody is blessed with a piece of land. So what we suggest is you can grow your own food, or at least support farmers who are growing chemical-free food. So in our markets, that's what we are trying to do, like making it available. So we have to see locally what is available. Many of the well-known this dietitians also suggest whatever is locally available, seasonal, fresh fruit, we have to consume that. So that is day-to-day. Even grains which are produced here, which are grown locally, we have to go for that. When we say we have to eat non-toxic food, how will we make sure? Then we have to encourage our local farmers to grow, and those who are growing by buying from them. Okay, when we go for packaged food and all, we really don't know from where it is coming and what are the ingredients. So small things like microgreens, we can grow in smaller trays and fulfill our smaller requirements for the daily nutrients in that. We can try growing locally our own this poultry, our own goat and all, and consume from them. Okay, and then when it comes to different nutrients, then seasonal fruits and vegetables are there, which can surely take care of. So actually going local is the mantra here. What we can see that when we are stopping the more packaging, we are having less shelf life, we have to consume it immediately in the raw form, in the natural form, the more healthy it can be for us. Yeah, so that is the thing.
All right. Basically, go local and eat healthy. Vinod, would you like to share with us your thoughts?
I think if we want to make a major shift, then it has to come from the users. It's always the public who has the power to make any change. I firmly believe in that. Although we need to work at both the ends, demand and supply both, but we need to do a lot of work so that it is pushed by the users. So if you see the recent shift, even if people are a little bit going towards alternative medicines, alternative systems of healing, why they are doing it? Because they have experienced the other mechanisms, and they've seen how, what it is doing, how much it has helped them, what are the alternatives, what side effects it has. So they have become aware, you know, on both the sides, and that's the reason they're saying now let's explore alternative. And that's the reason you see a lot of people talking about these things now. Suddenly organic farming, this is becoming a bigger thing, organic produce are bigger. So it's all by the user. So if we have to drive major force around it, I think people like us have to do a lot of awareness. Like Daryl was saying, either you know, it's a scare, this thing that, you know, what connect your food has with the illnesses and make them aware. You have to wake them up so that they are demanding good food. You know, I've worked in corporate industry, and I used to be one of those users who was just picking up stuff during the weekend, whatever is there closer to your basket. It doesn't matter what it is. So I think the major effort all of us have to do in creating awareness, in making people realize what is the connect and what can it this kind of food do to your health. So that is one part from the demand side. And second, as we said, you know, the impact of media or entertainment. The whole industry has to play a very responsible role, because they are one of the main thing which is having a deep impact on the children, whether it is, it's not only food, it's also about the health products, as Bhagishri was saying, that, you know, whatever is being sold as a health product, is it really health product? You know, if it has too much of sugar in it, then people, user has to be aware, you know, what is health product. So all these companies have to, you know, there have to be some rules around it, what kind of advertisement or, you know, what kind of things they need to publish to the users. And then government definitely has to play a very important role. Like Daryl also said, that if we can publish on a pack of cigarette that, you know, it can be dangerous. So something like that, if something is made up of maida, you know, let them write that it is dangerous to your intestine, too much consumption for a year or 2 years, you know, this might happen to your health. So let people read it. And why are they not writing it? And it is their responsibility. I would say, you know, it is the company's dharma. So if somebody is into food industry, when I say dharma, not religion, what they ought to do as per their role. Like a mother's role is to nurture child, to love the child, to feed the child. Similarly, if you are working in industry which is related to health, food, it is your dharma to give the food which is good for humanity. That should be your first goal. Whatever product you launch, it has to go through some steps. And, you know, there has to be some organization or this thing to back it. Does it pass on those parameters to be qualified as food, as Daryl said? Is it a food for human, or is it food for somebody else? Or, you know, if it is not even good for soil, why are you feeding to human? So like that. So there has to be very strict laws in food, and which has to come. And again, I would say it has to come from the users, you know, the push. This is what we want. This is wrong happening to us. And this needs to be done in the food industry, and it is very, very important. And then, as Bhagishri was saying, you know, working with farmers, there's a lot of, I come from a farmer community. My whole family was into this till last this thing, generation. So you have to educate farmers. You know, they are not aware people. Somebody told them, okay, if you use this packet, it will double your produce. They don't know what is chemical, not chemical, how much harmful, will it impact soil. People, farmers are realizing now in Rajasthan that it has damaged their soil. Now they are saying, how do we reverse the damage? They were not told a couple of years back that it will completely, you know, damage your soil in 15 years' time or 20 years' time. So somebody, you know, has to help them in this. So it is the responsibility of probably educating educated society, that some people should come forward as an organization or as a volunteers who can help those farmers in making them aware, spread awareness, educating them, or maybe doing some certifications for them to understand whatever they need to do in the farming this thing. And that's where they will be able to decide. Today, they are not the people who are deciding what needs to be grown in their farm, unfortunately. They are growing what companies wants them to grow, and at what speed and what quantity. Most of the times they are operating like that, unfortunately, due to lack of awareness. So there's a lot of effort has to go in that particular segment. And the most important thing was the taste part. There has to be a lot of innovation. Innovation has to be done in healthy food so that you can compete with Maggie and other stuff, you know, in terms of taste. So a lot of creative people has to come into it to do that. And definitely supporting local, seasonal. The importance of having local food or seasonal food or not having a processed or a frozen food or even fruits which comes, you know, to you after 20 days, 30 days. A lot of awareness has to go through it so that people promote, you know, go local, go seasonal. And that's the reason they will cut down on other chemical stuff. So these are a couple of things which is, I think, we all should do so that we can get healthy food back in the scene.
Absolutely, absolutely. Thank you, Vinod. It was very interesting, especially about educating the farmers. So now I'll ask Daryl to share with us.
Yes, thank you, Vana. So, it's very clear that now when you say that, people are getting sick in a nation, let's say for India, for example, it is known, you know, India is the diabetic capital of the world. And I think the leader in cataract surgeries and knee replacement surgeries also. And, for pioneering work of people, not only in India, but, in other countries too, have showed that, a plant-based diet is reversing so many of these illnesses. So healthy, organic, seasonal, plant-based detox kind of a diet is reversing all of these illnesses. And this is being done at, private organizations because the popular system of medicine, that is allopathy, is not curing any illnesses. It is just giving people, pills one after the other as a life support system. And when, the kidney fails after it cannot work anymore in medicines, then the operation theater is there. So that's why it's not a curative system. You remain on certain medicines for your illness and you get worse and worse. And then you have to have an eye surgery, knee surgery, take out your gallbladder and all of the operation, things that happen. But if you see, this is not the system there in, people or cultures who are living in the forest and all of that. They don't have their cataract and knee problems and, joint problems happening. So the question is that now who's responsible is it for this? At the every nation, we believe that we pay taxes and all that and our government should take care of this. But I don't understand what the research departments are doing. I don't see any big budgets or pioneering work. They don't pick up this knowledge from at least the people who are reversing all of these illnesses. Okay, and the organizations that are doing it still at a private level, the government is not taking up all of these solutions and implementing at a national level. So then how is the entire popular system in the country supposed to change? Right, it's not going to change. So you have no innovation research and, great recommendations in diet even or changes in diet being done by, countries. And even if US FDA, they were in charge of giving food pyramids to the world and they have been, it's called the sad American diet now. It's a diet on which people fall sick and get all these illnesses. So it's only, I'm saying, small sector people and people who use these healthier diets and diverse illnesses, they are the only people who can talk and teach to others. So I think education from such kind of people to the masses is the main criteria of, of any real reversal. Otherwise, in that absence, food manufacturing companies are just carrying on with their business. Like I said earlier, they don't care if we get cataract cancer or diabetes or whatever. Now, the other part is I just want to share my screen. Here's a picture. Okay. Now it's showing the fruit production chain. And this is the supply chain of food. So people are here at the end, at the lower end of the supply chain. They are eating, you know, in their homes or in a restaurant. Okay, and that's where the consumption happens. And I think, frankly, most people are just bothered about what is coming on the table or what's there in the store. And they think that the rest of this entire, you know, thing is run by, you can see, big entities and companies and, you know, warehousing, distribution, manufacturing, and then growing, you know, at very, very large scale. And the only people who can, now, if you find that there's something, you know, there's some packaged food product is causing, you know, cancer. Now, few number of people find that out. And then they go and they talk to the company and all that, you know, the company says, we have got the license, we have got the right to make this. No big organization on this planet is telling us it's getting cancer. No, you are mistaken. And, you know, you go back. And if you try to do any kind of legal action against them, all businesses are protected by law. And probably you lose, you know, trying to fight a case against them. So that is not changing, going to change anything by trying to oppose companies. The main thing is that, and we are also not trying to shut down businesses of companies who are making products that are causing illness. What we are just, we need to do is try to show them better way. If they didn't know what is healthy food, then we have to, you know, the people who have got success with healthy food need to show them what is healthy food. And they can make healthy food and make, you know, their business and profit. So the purpose of showing this supply chain of food is that the only change can come from the demand. You know, these people sitting at the table, if they are totally unaware that the damages that processed foods cause, then they're just going to be eating that every day. And the flow will happen through the, you know, they will keep on buying all the stuff from the retail or the supermarkets and the malls. And because the stock is being picked up, the warehouses will keep more and more, because it's the stock is moving from the warehouse, the manufacturer will be making more and more. Okay. So the whole supply chain is actually run by that table, that dinner table and that restaurant table. Okay. If people are okay eating cancerous foods and foods that cause sickness, then those foods will keep on coming inside the supply chain. And all across the supply chain, those people are very happy. They're making a lot of business. They're growing their, you know, profits are growing year and year. They are making, taking the company, their products to different and different companies, I mean, countries. So the only way to change it is by educating these people here in the home. That is common people, because they are the ones who are eating food every day. They are the real demand. They are the real system. The whole system is serving them. So I think the most important thing is to teach people this relationship between manufactured, unnatural food that is toxic and unhealthy, and show them all the cases of who had got sick and how they reversed their sicknesses with organic, local, fresh food every day. So once people start changing their decisions about what they can eat every day, and of course it has to be healthy. So there are, you know, probably 1 million recipe books on even traditional ones on how to make unhealthy food. But there may be hardly even 1,000 books in the world on how to, you know, make a really tasty and healthy food. So that's the difference. Okay, why people may not find, you know, healthy food tasty. They just need, and these, if we have to understand this whole skill of making unhealthy foods, or picking up, even in your house, you can make very unhealthy food in your house by, you know, putting too much sugar in it, or using too much of grains in your food, or milk and milk products, putting them inside food, and so many things. So all of these things have come down to tradition and hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of years. And that is why India is, you know, the diabetic capital and capital of so many other illnesses in the world, because we hold our tradition very, very high. And so if you're talking about healthy recipes, it's a very small, tiny movement. And only those people have used these healthy recipes and have got, you know, and made them tasty and reverse illnesses, they know the truth. So I think that information really has to go out more in the public domain from people who have done it. Otherwise, besides people who have done it, all the rest of the people in this food supply chain are all marketers and business people. And they have nothing to do with your health. They are just there to make money of, you know, giving you something that they call food. So I'm back here. That's the change I think that needs to happen in the world. The only way the system is going to change by educating people, and they should make healthy food choices every day. And the more they don't pick up all these processed and packaged food products, they will remain over there in the stores. Then they will data expire. That signal will go to the warehouse. That will go to the manufacturers, and the manufacturers will start making lesser of those foods. And when people say, instead of this, we want, you know, foods that are fresh and without preservatives, then that signal will go through the supply chain and manufacturers will start making that. That's how you have, you know, in the malls and all, now they've got an organic counter also. Many malls have got a fresh vegetable. You know, in Goa we have, but they don't say it's organic because it's not organic. At least there's fresh fruits and vegetables at one section. And there is also then organic grains and pulses at one section. Now, this change has not happened because the shops thought, we want to improve the health of everybody. So let us make a new section and let us invest in it. And, you know, we hope people will buy it. No, that didn't happen because of that. That happened because people came to the counters and said, do you have organic grains? Do you have this? Why don't you have fresh foods? And if you don't have, then what's the point in coming to your store? So the educated people are only changing the system. Nobody else can change the system. Right, so that I think is the most important way the whole supply chain can change. So education on food, and especially those people, it's a moral responsibility, I think, for those people who have, you know, got better health through fresh and natural food. They should share it with everybody. Otherwise, I don't see any other way that there's any hope in this world for, you know, better health if our food remains the way it is.
Right. Absolutely. Thank you, Daryl. This is basically it, you know, how we can remove the brainwashing on the people who are consuming the food so that they demand better and organic food. So this brings us to the next question, which is, how can our audience get in touch with you to learn more about health and environmentally safe choices? So I would ask Vinod to share with us, or you can even type in the chat box that people can see.
I'll do that also, I'll just talk about it. So as you said, I run this organization EcoLive. We call it EcoLive, not live. We say live ecologically, okay. Live in harmony with nature. So we promote the concept of living ecologically. We focus on human health and also the health of environment. So we while we work for human health through naturopathy, we also work on saving water, a lot of water initiatives, rainwater harvesting systems, waste management, solar energy. So working on both human health and environment. Our website is www.ecolive.in. We also have a Facebook page, ecolive.in. There's a YouTube channel also where we keep publishing small videos on water and health and waste management also. You can just watch them at your leisure. And as Daryl said, awareness has to go on. So you can watch yourself, you can share it with your friends, whatever topic connects with you. I think it is very, very important, and it is my humble request to all the users who are viewing it currently. Whatever awareness, you know, you get it from anybody, from us, from Daryl. If you watch something, please do share. At least each one, educate one. I always tell, not 10, not 100, at least each one, educate one new person on this whole concept. I think we will make a lot of change. So you can see our YouTube channel also, EcoLive, and we can be reached. I'll just type in my email ID also, and I would be happy to share anything, any questions, any information you need for health and environment work. Thank you.
Thank you, Vinod. I would request Bhagyashree to share with us how they can get in touch with you, the audience.
For us, like we have our Facebook page called Ease Eco Goa, basically to ease eco-friendly choices for Goan people. But now we deliver across different locations. And we are available on WhatsApp for your simple gardening doubts. There are any issues with your plants for manuring that. And about healthy choices, in our market, what we call for, like local farmers market here, like Sulimark Weekly, we are trying to get in touch with people and farmers who are growing chemical-free and to get their produce here so that it is available for the city people as well. And we are doing awareness every time. As pandemic allows, like as Daryl Sutt has said rightly, and Ms. Vinod Kumari ma'am also, that the awareness is very important. Then only people will get aware about why to choose this and where it is available. And when that they test, the real test of like chemical-free food, the locally grown food, then only they know ki, ha, this is something different and I need to go for this. They understand the value of this. We organize a different workshop. Because of pandemic, we are not doing anymore, but online we will be coming. We are interviewing a lot of farmers, their different additional practices, which can help us in that. So we have to really get aware and get cautious about our health. Yeah. I will be sharing our WhatsApp number where you can let us know your queries about this, where we can actually help you to reach to local farmers. Yeah.
So now I would request Daryl to share with us how the audience can reach and know more about these initiatives.
So some resources are, you know, my health website, becomehealthyorextinct.com. You can go there and download my book and, you know, read all of this. There's a chapter on what I spoke just now, this managing our food supply chain. And of course, the book teaches you all the, you know, healthy diet and the choices that are good for health and for the environment also. Then another resource is we have very good videos from last year's summit on our YouTube channel. So just go to YouTube and search for the New Earth Summit. Okay, YouTube channel. And you can watch all of last year's videos. It will teach you a lot. There are very good videos on what is healthy food, what is unhealthy food, what are the, you know, alternative choices that you can make. And for people who want to do reverse chronic illnesses with integrative natural therapy, that's what I teach, a combination of diet and nutrition, then natural organ cleanses, acupressure, herbs for healing, and a few other, you know, simple therapies. You can, on my health website, you'll find a section for workshops. There I have an online workshop, and so people can, you know, do the online workshop also. And for those who want to know about my work in organic farming and environment in our different groups in different cities, WhatsApp groups and Facebook groups, where we work on health, nutrition, healing, different healing modalities, organic farming. For all of these resources, go to my main website, daryldesouza.com. There you'll see links to about 7 of my websites where all of this different work is going on. Yes, so that is how people can get in touch with me. I stopped doing personal one-to-one consultations at the starting of this year, because I'm working more on organic farming and events like this and environment projects also. But people who will, you know, read my book completely and do my online workshop, then they know most of the integrated system that I'm teaching, and it's then I don't have to sit and do, you know, 3-4 hours consultation for them, because half of the consultation just goes into explaining to people what are all the wrong recommendations that were given to them till the date. You know, by people who are in the business of, you know, treating people, and people are just getting treated and treated, but not getting cured. So, of course, everybody is trying to do their best. And I think it's the awareness and the knowledge of, so there's a lot of wrong information out there. And you, a very sincere doctor or, you know, nutritionist also trying to do their best may give you information that they think is really right. And the bottom line is, if you take that information and apply it in your life, are you reversing your obesity, diabetes, and, you know, hormonal imbalance and all that within 3 months? You know, that is what it takes. It just takes about 3 months to reverse all these things if you do them right and if you're working with the person who has the right kind of information. So I have all of my cases, you know, even doctors who have come to me in Goa reversing diabetes in less than 2 months and high blood pressure in 2.5 months and then also getting off their heart medication in 3 months. Okay, so only when these people know how true it is. Whereas other general public says, yeah, my doctor is giving me medicine, he's treating me for diabetes, and, you know, it's been 6 months, and, you know, my sugar from, you know, this 180, it's come down to 160, and there's improvement, and I think it's really nice. And then I'm doing some little bit of yoga, and from 160, it's come to 150, you know, and I think that's really working. So that means, you know, you will have to do those treatments for the rest of your life. So I'm saying, yes, there are genuine people and everybody's trying to do a good job. But the real right information, that is what reverses these illnesses within 3 months. Okay, so don't accept things like this. 6 months, it's going to take me to drop 7-8 kilos. No, I've had people drop 20 kilos, okay, in 3 months. So, yeah. So look out for testimonies from people who have said they've had amazing, you know, healing experiences within just 2-3 months with the right kind of diet, nutrition, natural therapy, moderate exercise. Those are the things that work.
Great. Thank you, Daryl. And now we'll move to the Q&A and the chats which have been coming in. So I'll just take up this first question, which is from Nestor Rangel, which is, should we stop non-veg foods totally? Anyone who would like to take this? I think Daryl would like to.
Yes, okay. I will comment on that because I have seen that it's the same topic, different levels of information and understanding. Now, you will see that people who have done really deep work in nutrition, when I say deep work in nutrition, doesn't mean that you go to a nutritional college and learn what was there in the textbooks and all of that, okay? It is little more than that, because I've seen a lot of that. There's a difference between real life, what is happening. Now, who is the one who really knows about nutrition? Who should be called a food scientist? Okay. It is somebody who has worked from food right from the point of origin. And where does food originate? Okay, food originates. Now, all food on this planet is made by plants. Okay, the plants are the ones whose roots will take from the mother earth, from the soil and the water and all of that, and absorb into their body. And they will reach out to the, what I say, father sky, air and the sun. And they will pull in that energy. And while bringing those things together, they create food. Even carnivorous animals, they eat herbivorous animals. Herbivorous animals don't make food. They eat the plants. Okay, so the real producers of food on this planet have always been and will always be, because we are designed that way, is plants. So the basic understanding is how do plants, you know, make food. So the real nutritionists are that person who knows about the soil. How do soil nutrients come into the plant? You know, what is plant immunity? And if the plants have got good immunity, they will fight pests. And they have good immunity if they have good mineralization. If we eat organic, well-mineralized plants, then we get high immunity and high health. Fresh, organic, local, seasonal, high mineralized plants. And they are much more tasty. Okay. So the nutritionist, actual nutritionist is the one who knows how this happens. Not just the organic, natural farmer. There's sometimes some farmers are there, you know, they don't put chemicals in the soil and they say that, okay, our produce is organic. But the nutrition in their plants is not high unless they've done real soil biology. So for me now, it's becoming imperative that, you know, people understand this planetary ecology and soil biology and all well, and they have to look and observe in the real life. The real college is life itself. what is taught in college is a theory and some things. And why I'm saying this knowledge that has come from these colleges and all, I mean, of course, colleges are getting progressive now, and nutrition is getting, you know, better and better, I think, since the last 10 years. But till that time, those sciences and this American diet and all that, that has created, you know, 70% of sicknesses in the world. It's coming through food. The rest is, of course, 30% is on, you know, sedentary lifestyle or emotional problems and the external environment. So the once you start following and you do the complete study, this is a complete study. How does the ape, monkey, chimpanzee, how do they get such strong bones and so flexible? How can they swing from, you know, the entire 300 kgs? How can they swing from half of their, you know, half the digits of their fingers from branch to branch? You know, how can the great ape do that? So when you look at them, because they're the closest to human beings, okay, when you look at them, you will see how their nutrition flows. Okay, and all of these and so many other mammals, sentient, I call, you know, five senses, mammalian, vertebrates. Okay, we have to look at the sentient mammalian vertebrates that are vegetarian and that have characteristics like ours. Okay, not canines for killing other animals, no big claws and digestive tract that matches us. When you see how the nutrition and vegetarian nutrition flows, only then you know nutrition. Yeah, unless you've done that study, you do not know nutrition. Okay, so I work like that with living sciences. And then of course, that is one class. And the second class is when you take that and you apply it on the human body and you see people who are sick, reversing illnesses because of these diets, then you know this is the real science, because this is the science that not only it reverses all the damage that was done with the bad food. So coming to that, once you go in this direction, you will see that human beings naturally are not meat eaters. Okay, and you can have meat instead of too much of rice and wheat and too much of sugar in your diet. Yes, you will lose weight, because actually milk and milk products and sugar and too much of wheat and rice, that will give you acidity and also you know, weight gain and also tendency towards diabetes. Now you reduce your milk and you reduce the grain and you go and eat meat. Now meat is not going to give you that much obesity. Neither is going to give you, you know, diabetes. And but it is going to be acidic and it will age the human body faster. So instead of living to 100 years, you will live to 90 years or maybe 85 years. But that doesn't mean that, oh, meat was healthy and I lost weight because of meat. You lost weight because you didn't have, you know, that too much of hormone overdose through milk and milk products, too much of fat through grains, and you know, all of that. So I've seen that people who have transitioned from a meat eating diet to a vegetarian diet, and have also seen that they eat organic, local, healthy, and they've eaten from well mineralized soils, and they have had a good balance of food. That is, fruits, vegetables, nuts, beans, peas, roots, grains, seeds, all of those things regularly distributed in the diet. They are outperforming people, you know, in creative arts, in mind power, in physical, you know, fitness, in agility, in sports as well. So I'm seeing that happen for the people who have the real right sciences. And for those who do not have the real right sciences, you know, they're half educated in this flow of food. They can just look, oh, there is a, you know, they will go and eat any animal that has had the right, that is following the right sciences, right? So I tell people, please don't go and eat our teachers, okay? That particular animal, that particular species that is there in the natural wildlife that is doing the things right. You please learn from them what they're doing right to get their protein and their energy and their flexibility and no cataract, no glaucoma and no bone problems and all that. You know, follow them. That is the study. But instead, our people are going and eating those. Oh, their meat has got vitamin D, it's got B12, it's got this, it's got that, it's got so much of protein and everything. So this is not science for me. That you go and eat the species on the planet, that has got the real science.
Thank you, Darren. The next question which has come on Q&A is by Abhay Morle, what type of intoxicants are we transmitting in our upcoming generation? If anyone would like to take this, Vinod?
Sure, sure. So, as we said, we are made up of food. Whatever we are consuming today, that becomes us. Now, whatever next generation we are bringing into this planet will be part of us and will be much more like us. And if you see the gradual decline in the health, which has happened in last probably 20, 30 years, it's because of the shift in the food which we are consuming now. So if we continue the current trend, I think the prediction, and we already know that, you know, what percentage even the children are having, you know, brain issues or mental issues, or even born with type 1 diabetes, type 2 diabetes. I mean, these kind of signs, we have not seen it earlier. And it's happening right in front of our eyes. We are seeing it, how we are transmitting. So it's a sin which we are doing to the next generation by our act and by becoming unaware that it is actually being transmitted to the next generation. So including the physical body and even the mind part, combining these two, what we are maintaining, how we are maintaining this body, we have to be very responsible, you know, rather than thinking, oh, I can't do anything about my health. You know, this is how, you know, some people tell me obesity is hereditary in our family, which I tell, you know, this is not something which can be hereditary. It's because you have been following the same lifestyle which they followed and you are also doing it. You change and you'll see the change. You will see the shift. So it's the key thing how we are managing ourselves. And if we have a lot of toxins in our body, definitely that will get transmitted to your next generation also. So we have to be very, very responsible and aware about this.
Absolutely, absolutely. Thank you, Vinod. The next question is, does deep underground borewells, fossil water, add toxicants to crops and its products?
So a comment that I want to make on that is, you know, this borewell water, I think the first thing that people need to do is go and, you know, get that water tested and see what is in the water, if there is, you know, any kind of, you know, harmful substances in it or too much heavy metal and all of that. Does it have, you know, the right kind of constitution? That's the first thing that people need to check. I have been seeing more cases of anal abscess. Okay. Anal abscess is like bacteria getting into the anus and, you know, eating up the cells slowly. They say, I mean, most doctors will not tell you this about abscess. Oh, abscess is just an abscess. It's a decay and it's, you know, dying. And there's a small wound happening in the body. And people have to have operations and they have, you know, it's cut up and flesh is taken out and they've got a small, you know, dip over there. It's cells of the human body, they never malfunction. It is some germs that go in and start eating the cells, and that's why it becomes an abscess. And they have to then cut it open and cut out that flesh that looks like cancerous and all that, and eaten up and take it out. And then they have to, they take patches of skin from the other body and flesh and try to patch it up. Now, I have seen that this is happening more in cases in cities where they are having in their overhead tanks, you know, one tank is borewell water, and that borewell water comes into the toilets, and from the toilet for flushing it, it's okay. But from the toilet, if you use a health faucet, with you're actually putting health faucet water on your anus, that is coming from borewell, very deep water. And I think all city waters at that level are all contaminated with chemicals and whatnot. Okay. In fact, even in my own toilet in Bombay, whenever I go and I flush the toilet, you get a very foul smell and a gray color in that water, which is not the smell and the color of the water that you get from the natural piping which comes from the lakes. Okay, so I've seen enough evidence of this already regarding health problems and wrong strains of bacteria and some toxins and chemicals coming out of very deep borewell water. And I don't know what is this concept of, you know, we know that the devastation that has happened in Punjab, and they are all digging borewells to 300, 400 feet and getting up that water from the center of the earth and putting in their fields. I have a high suspicion that that is what is killing the soil, and, you know, that is part of the problem, I think. So definitely, if somebody's trying, you know, borewell water for farming, you please get it chemically thoroughly checked and see that, you know, it's good. And again, go to the New Earth Summit website of last year and watch our video on rainwater harvesting. Rainwater harvesting is something that will save this planet, and we have to get our groundwater level higher and higher, our well water level higher and higher, so it's easy accessible for our farming. Okay, this rain that falls on top on the land, that is very good and healthy water. Even during this summit, if I have that document open in front of me, I'll tell you the exact date where we are having a webinar on attend on 21st October, where we're having the webinar for sewage treatment and disposal system. That means your black water and gray water, how it can be recycled and used, so conserving water, or it can be used to water your garden and all your fruiting plants and trees. Okay, it is converted by good microorganisms and made very healthy and nutritious water. So be there on 21st to understand the science of water, and then also be there on 24th of October, effective rainwater harvesting systems. So what I'm clearly saying is that the future science is not how to get that, you know, borewell water and all from the center of the earth. It is how you get healthy water and you conserve it and you start bringing up the water tables, you know, in every state and country. That is what is needed to be done. We need to bring the earth back to what it was when, and that is where we were healthy. We have destroyed all this groundwater and so many other systems, and it, all of these natural healthy resources are depleted. And so the consequence is sickness, cancer, and all of these things are happening.
Yes. The next question is from Sarita Chauhan. Do you suggest going oil free and without ghee? And if cashew and coconut intake impacts cholesterol levels? Vinod, you would like to take this?
So I will answer from naturopathy perspective. Definitely when we talk about going vegan, there are a couple of things which goes out of your system. Daryl was mentioning that if we pick up if we regularly are having that oil from nuts, which are like almonds and, the other nuts, or even the seeds also, there are good seeds also, then probably you don't need it. But if you talk about ghee, we do prescribe A2, which is Desi Gai ghee, which you can have if you don't have any other health condition, which is, not supporting it, probably 1 or 2 tablespoons in your, the regular food. But then again, depending upon your age, your health condition, then what kind of activity you do, it all depends. We always say there is nothing bad created on this planet. All the intelligence which you need, as Daryl was saying, that what to be used, for whom, where, what quantity, that is the real expertise. You know, you can have cashews, but in what stage, what quantity, and along with that, what all other things you have. So similarly, if you want to have ghee, yes, you can have ghee. What is the best ghee? A2 ghee, if you really want to have. And that too, you should know what is the quantity. And cholesterol, if we talk about cholesterol, it's not a direct equation. If you have cashew, you will have high cholesterol. No. It's again, how good your body is at processing anything. Whatever you eat, how good you are processing, how good your ingestion, you are absorbing, and then how good you are at throwing out the toxins or the waste material out of your system. So you might have seen, you know, I come from Rajasthan. People eat, eating desi ghee laddus in winters is a must in each and every house. And you check their cholesterol, including my father who is 76, they don't have any cholesterol. You know, so you need to know how to eat it right and at the right time and how to digest it right. So you need to consult an expert for these specific things. There's nothing bad on this planet.
Absolutely, absolutely. Thank you.
Daryl, you want to add something to it?
Yeah, yes, yes. So, you know, about, so as far as oils go, like I gave the example already, right? There are no other species on this planet who are having fried food and adding oils to their food. So you will see all the chimpanzees, monkeys, great apes, and all, they're eating all natural foods that have got oils. Okay, now people, first of all, it's a wrong classification by the modern system of food, where, you know, you take a grain of rice and you call it, you know, this carbohydrate, okay, complex carbohydrate. There's a little bit of fat, there's a little bit of oil also in it, there's fiber also in it, right? So all these things, so we don't understand. We say where we get our oils from. Right, so many things are there. There are leaves, there are seeds, beans, peas, and so many other, you know, vegetables also that they have different proportions of these things. So, so for those people who are not getting the right, you know, combination of oils at a regular level for them, maybe they can try, you know, other oils or like ghee and all of that. Sometimes in Ayurveda also, molecules have properties, and when they're combined with certain things, they can be medicinal. So I think sometimes, you know, in Ayurveda also as prescribed medicinally, I will agree to that medicinally with a combination ghee and all can be therapeutic. But I don't advise these things for regular food. So what we have to understand is that nature and natural things have made human beings. Scientists in laboratory have not made human beings. Robots have not made theories, and all those things have not made human beings. Okay. So all these people who have make our, you know, food products and all, they have not made us. They don't know our science. So we have to look from where we came, and from where we came is natural. And if you watch my TEDx talk, it says one law is that God, you know, made, or creator, or whatever you, universal consciousness, whatever you want to call it. It has given every living species in its natural form food all over the planet. And that's why all the species are alive. Okay, so that's the law. And if you look at human beings, we are the only ones having sicknesses. None of the other species are having any of our sicknesses. So their food and everything is, you know, matching really well. So if we try to stick more to natural foods, natural oils and all that, that would be the best. So there's a lot of evidence in my book also. I've explained how too much of refined cooking oil causes diabetes and acidity and cholesterol and inflammation of the arteries and the veins and all of that. Okay, so regular fried food is going to give you all these things. And related to cholesterol. So what is cholesterol? Cholesterol are small, yellow, natural, basic molecules of life that are made by the liver in the case of a human being. Okay. It is not existing in coconut and in cashew. There's no plants don't make cholesterol. So that's a completely wrong concept by those people who don't understand even basic functioning of the human body and its organs. So why does the liver make cholesterol? Now I'll give you another comparison. An egg, a raw egg, right? It's got that yellow inside, and most of it are cells of cholesterol. So what are the cells of cholesterol? Are basic body building cells that as the organism grows, they form into something of that structure of the body. So when you get an injury, okay, for example, you're brushing your teeth and your toothbrush hits your gum and there's a cut, so it'll bleed, right? And then after 1-2 days, what happens? It burns and all, but a yellow line comes there. What is that yellow line? Okay, now this is the same mechanism that's happening in your arteries, in your veins. So this yellow thing is cells of cholesterol. Where did they come? The blood supplies them over there. From where does cholesterol come in the blood? The liver produces. When does the liver produce? So there's an injury on the body. Signal goes to the brain. The brain says there's an injury, tells the liver, please release cells of cholesterol. The liver makes it, and those cells travel everywhere. Wherever there's no damage in the body, they don't deposit. But where there's damage, they deposit. So they come and they fill up that space, and you get a yellow thing that becomes, one in 2-3 days, it becomes pink, and then you have your gum intact and healed. Okay, so this is what cholesterol is. Cholesterol is basic cellular building block. So if you get a cut on your cheek, it'll be yellow there and it will heal. A hurt on outside of your body is a different mechanism. There's dry air and a scab and fiber and blood and all, and blood plasma comes and makes a wound of it. But there's no dry air inside your body, right? From this point that you can see, even from your mouth till your anus, there is no great air to make a scab. So this yellow substance is the healing thing. So who's that person who's going to have yellow at different places? There's an ulcer in the stomach, there's a duodenal ulcer, the plaque and cholesterol in the arteries. From where do they come? It only comes from people eating unnatural foods that cause erosion of the intestines and inflammation and through the arteries. Okay, so all of these processed food products that have got all these chemicals, you just think of them that there are like, there's a hand going in which has got nails and it's scratching your entire digestive tract. So there are scratch marks everywhere. They're inside your veins, inside your arteries. So fried food, too much of refined cooking oil, that is going to create inflammation and damage. Too much of acidic meats. The most high is this processed food with all these chemicals that go in. Too much of sugar also in your diet is going to create acidity and intestinal inflammation. And these are the things that harden the walls of the arteries. So when the arteries harden, they start cracking from inside. And that crack is only repaired by cholesterol. The cholesterol cells go there and they fill up that crack. And if you take a cross section of that in a laboratory and you cut it up, you can see the yellow. So that yellow is just repairing damage. Okay, so cholesterol is a repairing mechanism of the human body. And once you stop the damage, only then it'll take about 4 to 5 months, because there's so much damage caused all your life, and your liver will keep on producing cholesterol till all your damage is repaired in your stomach, in your intestines, in your arteries and all of that. And so for reversal of cholesterol, it takes about 4 to 5 months from the date that you stop having fried foods. You can bake, boil, roast, steam to have cooked food. Even now air fryers, that's, you got 5 modes of cooking food. Okay, I'm not saying to have raw food. Read page 149 of my book, and also page 109 and 110, which will explain why human beings need to eat some amount of cooked food also. Because we are in different environments of cities and with chappals and not getting sun. So we need little more of, you know, earth element. If you are living in the forest only, like all other species, sentient mammalian vertebrates, we would not need any cooked food. So there's a very deep science to this, which is real science. And this is not the science you will get in some laboratory and some, you know, scientist who's been studying in colleges all of their life. You won't get real science from them.
Thank you, Dad. The next question is, could you please tell some superfoods for great hair and skin by Sanam Mirpuri?
Hair and skin.
Yes.
Okay. So first of all, let me tell you, hair and skin is never from outside. Oh. It's never ever from outside. And the common sense is, how is it growing? As Daryl was saying, we have to observe nature very closely. You know, if a plant grows, what is the main thing? It's the root from where it is taking ingredients. So similarly, we have to see, you know, this is the outer part. Skin is the covering layer of this human body, but how it is getting formed, and, you know, it's again that nutrition, what you are eating, that plays the most important role. Yes, the external application helps whenever there is a need in emergency or for a short-term thing. If you're feeling a little dry, you can put something, or once in a while you can do things. But majority, the health of your skin and hair is dependent on what kind of food you eat and also how good is your digestion and absorption. It's again the same thing. So typically, you know, for the hair and this thing, you know, good things are, again, nuts are very good things. Berries are very good things. In the winters, have a lot of green stuff, you know, spinach or all green vegetables. The more alkaline things you will have, it will have very, very good effect on your body. And I would like to highlight, since Navratris are coming, try experiencing fasting where you eat all alkaline food for 9 days and see the change in your skin and your hair. And a real example, you know, Daryl is there. You see his hair and the glow on his skin. So he's off milk products. He's off non-veg. So he's probably eating, if not less, Daryl, 90% alkaline or 80%?
So I do a balance. So the general thing is that people are eating too much acidic. So we say, you know, eat more alkaline. But yes, along, you know, you, if you eat nuts and if you eat grains, then those are acidic, of course. Yeah.
So having overall, more of alkaline, that so is something.
More of, yeah, not 90% on all, just try to have more of alkaline food. Yeah.
Yes.
And a balance. So I would agree with, you know, Vinod, that nuts are an important part of, you know, the natural oils, because when you're scalp doesn't get that nutrition of enough of natural oils, then it dries up and the hair follicle is sitting, you know, the hair is sitting in a kind of a follicle here that's dry, so it falls out easily. But if it's nice and moist and wet, it holds the hair properly. So nuts are an important thing, good oils in your body regularly. The second thing about hair fall is that intestinal health. Anybody who has got a toxic colon, okay, they will experience hair fall and hair loss. Also inflammation in the intestines. So that's why nowadays you are having people, you know, getting bald. Even, you know, a man is getting bald at the age of 40 when his father also did not get bald at the age of 55. So why is that happening? Okay, because his father was not eating so much of packaged food and processed food products, and he had very less intestinal inflammation. Okay, so we have to understand that these things of our human, the appendages or the externalities of the human body, they represent what's happening inside. I'll just give you an example. You know, so the starting of our digestive tract is here, you know, the tongue. So if you see the color of the tongue and you know how it is, whether it's very red, it's got spots or cracks and all that, because you take your navel, right? Your navel, whatever is going wrong from upwards of your navel, if there's any intestine or, you know, toxicity in that, your stomach, your duodenum, the first part of your, you know, your small intestine, all that toxicity, where is it going to come out? It'll come out as sweat and all that, but it also tries to come up like this. Okay, and from below your navel, so if you say 23 or 25 meters of intestine, so 12 of it is going to express itself down, that is through your anus. So, you know, piles, fissures, and all of that. Anybody who's having piles and fissures and all that, they're going to have hair fall because the colon is experiencing inflammation. Okay, so also our scalp is an externality of what is inside the human body. There's too much heat within your digestive tract, that heat will rise up and it will dry up your scalp. The water content and moisture in your scalp will dry up. When that dries up, your roots will become dry and your hair will become thin and it will fall out, okay, easily. This is also like, you know, that's why I'm saying all of this. If there's a organic farmer or soil biologist, they know that certain amount of humidity in the soil, okay, will nourish the plant and hold the plant, and the plant, the grass or whatever, it will grow thick. But if lack of nutrition and humidity in the soil, the blades of grass will come out thin and they won't have good produce on them. So similar thing. So for me, hair fall is about too much of heat in the body. And in fact, in my book, there is, you know, treatment for excess heat in the body. It involves kadi sakar and black pepper. And people who take that for about 20 days, they see regrowth of hair happening starting from the 15th day to the 30th day. Okay, because that cuts down heat in the digestive tract. So very clearly, there's a direct correlation between inflammation in the intestines and colon causing hair fall. And I explained earlier also, inflammation in the intestine is coming from all this. Too much of fried food, too much of processed foods, too much of meat. Okay.
Sure. Thank you, Daryl. The next question which is there, from Hemant Pawar. Hello, Daryl. I don't have acidity, but I see a lot of people with that problem who, in spite of change in diet, can't seem to get rid of it. What could be going wrong?
So now, yeah, so some people will say, you know, this soft drinks, Coke, Mirinda, Pepsi and all, they're also one of the most acidic foods that you can have. And the only thing more acidic than them is, you know, regular drinking of milk. Okay. That's explained in my book, why it's so acidic. Because the, you know, the main constituent of this milk, you know, it's 18 times this protein. It's 18 times heavier in molecular weight than, human breast milk counterpart. I'm forgetting now. But it's that heavy molecule that goes into the body that the stomach produces more lower pH of acid to break it down. Because once you put it into the human body, it's got to, you know, digest it. So that causes acidity. So vegetarians also will be getting acidity from too much of grains, too much of Coke, Mirinda, Pepsi, too much of milk and milk products regularly. And so that could be a reason for the acidity first versus the food. Second is that they could be having some bacterial infection, like too much of H. pylori bacteria that causes acidity also and ulcers in the stomach, duodenal ulcer and all of that. And so ways to heal that is, you know, change your diet and see how to use natural herbs to kill bacteria and infection in the digestive tract. And then the third is use, acupressure for stomach point and all of that is here. On the left hand, it's for the incoming sphincter to your muscle. On the right hand, it's for the outgoing sphincter, which is going to the duodenum. So at both those sphincter places, there could be inflammations and people get acidity, burps for it. So using acupressure, you can heal both of them. And then there are also herbs, some herbs for healing, acidity. If you go to my website, Become Healthy or Extinct, in herbal remedies, there's a remedy from a company called Kiva, where it says acidity drops. And you go to that acidity drops, it's all herbal medicine. And you've seen the ingredients, those herb names, which heal acidity. Okay.
All right. The next question which is there is, in spite of eating healthy, I still get severe migraines. How do I deal with them? Sharmila Sinkar.
So, first of all, the stung migraine has become so common that for every headache, people are using it. First, we need to know what is triggering it. You know, there are multiple reasons of having that headache. It can be either high acid in your body, which is leading to, migraine or headache issues. It can be high, gastric issues, which can lead to these things. Some people have some specific allergy, or even when they go out in the sun, then they have specific health condition. So the first step is definitely to, go to the root cause. And the fact that you have changed the food and still not impacting your, condition, I think need to get it evaluated again, that what is the cause, because that is the solution. It's very difficult to say, you know, do A, B, C and it will reduce your migraine. But first going to the root cause, and definitely one thing which helps is pranayams and a few things in the acupressure, which Daryl teaches. So you can, you know, whenever it happens, you can do that. And just whenever it is happening, there's one thing which we teach in naturopathy is basically doing an ice massage immediately whenever you have it. So first, please go to the root cause and see why it is happening. But I'm just telling you that in case you feel it is about to happen, then you can do an ice massage at the back of your head from neck to here when it is about to start. So that's where it helps a lot. And if it is not a migraine and generic, you know, some health, you are having headaches because of, you know, sometimes even issues, you know, you have muscle spasm, or in many cases we have seen because of the neck stiffness also, people have regular headaches. So please check the root cause first and then treat. I think you need to change because I think food part is sorted. So find out the cause of your migraine first.
Absolutely. Thank you, Vinod. Next question is, what should we do to restrict nail and hair growth?
Yeah, I think we need to understand what is the, you know, what does it mean? Is it because of the, you know, somebody talking about the excess hair growth, which they want to restrict? I think then we should answer.
Yes, absolutely. The next one is, what are the problems faced by farmers while taking the move from inorganic farming to organic farming?
Yes, I'll just very briefly, you know, share about it. Like yesterday, they shared with us that it takes about 3 years, okay, to get that organic certification under the scheme where they are rolling out all of these organic clusters across the country. But depending on what kind of soil and how toxic it is and what's inside, it could take many years to make a soil organic, if there are chemicals or if it was in certain, you know, industries. And some places, if the feed of, you know, chemicals is there, then you can, you know, it's very, very difficult to convert that land if it's always the water seepage is coming in. If you have land that is, you know, basically not exposed to chemicals and all that, and even in a place like Goa, which is a sandy place, I created fertile soil, you know, within 1 year. So it was just, and I was growing plants on it for the, you know, at least 1, 2, 3 cycles of growing I did around my house. And now that, you know, sandy soil and red mud has become black mud. So, and anything grows on it very easily and faster. So you can, so it's very specific to a particular plot of land, you know, where you have toxicity on which side and how much of a barricade that you can, or distance you can create it from the place that you are. But creating soil and good healthy soil is, if you know the science and if you do follow natural principles and natural farming methods, and you do a lot of, you know, composting and getting nutrients from a close by jungle, topsoil from a close by jungle, and, you know, spreading it on your soil also, so the soil organisms start coming on your land. Those are very effective methods to, you know, get good soil. So follow the permaculture principles and natural farming principles that look at, you know, what's there in your territory, in your area that can be, you know, used and composted, and a lot of nitrogen or carbon from plants and trees and dried leaves can be put in the soil. So it really depends on that, how fast you understand that science and how much you can do. And according to that, you know, your soil can become organic and natural.
Yes, thank you, Darren. This question has come from an anonymous attendee. My dad is 74 years old who has sleep apnea and using a BiPAP machine. Recently, he has had an angiography done which shows 70% block. Any reversal chances If so, please suggest a clinically safe and proven method to reverse it.
Yeah, now one of the first reasons that fat builds up in our internal tissues and our, you know, sinuses and all that, one of the principal causes for that is milk and milk products. Okay, so the first thing is to get off milk and milk products completely. It's complete unnatural science. Like I explained earlier, there are no mammals on the planet having milk after the age of 3 or 4 years. And once you read my book, you'll understand how much excess of fat and that is going in the human body on a regular level, how it brings the lipid profiles also up and contributes to diabetes. Okay, so, and then also this person, they should avoid sour foods and vinegar-based foods. And they should use healing herbs that will heal all the sinuses and heal the inflammation in the entire respiratory tract. Okay, and again, on just you can use Tulsi tea also. There's a very good product on my website, which is again a herbal remedy. It's called Panch Tulsi. It's just the, you know, the liquid extract of 5 medicinal varieties of Tulsi. And people with cough and cold and, you know, sinus, they see reversal of their symptoms in 4-5 days. Okay, the healing starts. But of course, I always follow a comprehensive strategy. First is stop the wrong actions or wrong foods that you are doing that are creating this condition. Then you bring in some healing. So stop is the, like I said, milk and milk products, sour foods, vinegar based foods. Next is bring in the healthier replacement. So you can have nut milks and all of that. They do not cause any cholesterol or sinus or hormonal imbalance. Okay, because with animal's milk, a lot of hormonal imbalance is also going on in the system. And if you look at hormones and endocrine glands, so it starts from your pineal, pituitary, thyroid, thymus, okay, adrenal, pancreas, then it goes into your sex glands also. So any high hormonal, the estrogen levels in cow's milk are 30 times higher than the estrogen levels in the human body. So that's the amount of hormonal imbalance you expose your body to when you have these products. And the primary cause of in women and youngsters, girls having irregular periods right from the age of 13 and 14, and then fibroids in the uterus. First they get cysts, PCOS or PCOD by the time they're 16, 17, 18, and then they get fibroids in the uterus by the time they're 22. So all of this is coming from that high level of estrogen that is being, you know, marketed and put across TV and all by, like I said, they're all businesses who are out for making anything that will, that they can market and sell to us and we can give them their money. They could have made nut milks, and that revolution is happening now. Some milk companies are taking nut milks because they're understanding that people are becoming wiser. And they are stopping all of this. The statistics are already there. So billions of, you know, dollars of came down in the production of animals' milk. Sales lesser happened, and plant milks are going up. They're all businesses, but I support healthy businesses where I've seen that they're healthy for the human body and for the planet. So this is what the person can use. And the main thing is that also weight. Generally, people who are having this sleep apnea, they are overweight. Again, that weight is coming from milk and other things also. So try to get, follow any person who is overweight. If you follow the diet on my book in page 149, you will see that normal, gradual, by eating enough of food, but doing the right choice of food, your body weight will start coming down to what is more ideal for your body. So for this person, definitely, if they are overweight, then weight needs to come down according to their BMI index. And then the things that I've already suggested, that should be done.
Great. Thank you, Daryl. And thank you, Vinod Kumari. We've reached the end of our webinar. And I would like to thank everybody, our panelists and our attendees. And I would just like to inform our attendees that tomorrow we will have a continuation onto the next topic, which is coming in plant food choices for people, animals, or the planet. So stay tuned, and we hope to see you again tomorrow. All right.
Thank you so much.
Yes. Thank you, Vinod, for coming. Thank you, Verna.
Thank you.
All the best.